non-invasive respiratory support in the neonatal intensive care unit, and minimally invasive surfactant technique, which is gaining momentum in the current era of non-invasive methods of giving surfactant. Before we start the main presentation, I have a disclosure to make that I have received no financial compensation from any sponsor in the production of this talk, and I have no conflict of interest to disclose. In the next 30 or minutes or so, we'll be covering about the physiology of the CPAP, what is the use of CPAP in day-to-day neonatal care, what are the different types of CPAP machines which are available, what are the different interfaces available, which one of them to choose, when to give surfactant, what is the classification of surfactant, what are the different newer modalities of giving surfactant, what is the evidence, is there any evidence, if at all, and what are the various complications of CPAP. The CPAP was first brought into clinical practice by Gregory et al. In 1971. He described CPAP as a missing link between supplemental oxygen and mechanical ventilation. However, there were certain complications like pneumothorax and gastric distension, and it was not as effective in VLBW babies. So because the ventilators were of good quality and CPAP had some complications, people began to use mechanical ventilation left and right, and it was the main primary respiratory support for babies with respiratory distress. As people began to use ventilation, they began to observe various forms of lung injury, which are collectively known as villi or ventilation-induced lung injury, leading to BPD. Subsequently, in 1990s, a pioneer work by Werder et al. Showed that CPAP, when given in combination with surfactant, can significantly reduce the need of mechanical ventilation and surfactant. Thereby, it led to the resurgence of CPAP. And since the last two decades, we are seeing CPAP as the backbone of the respiratory center, respiratory care in our intensive care units. And this led to a concept of gentilation. That is, try to be as gentle as possible in terms of respiratory support. So people began to shift from invasive to non-invasive mode of ventilation, with CPAP being the front runner. Subsequently, there were various landmark trials. However, I would like to mention the two trials, that is the support and coin trials, which were done in less than 28 weekers babies. They showed that CPAP alone is a safe alternative to intubating at birth and giving surfactant. The results of both these trials show that the use of CPAP can lead to almost 50% decrease in the need of surfactant, and CPAP alone does not lead to increased morbidity in terms of BPD or mortality. That is, mortality and BPD both were comparable to mechanical ventilation when used as a primary respiratory support. Now, how do we define CPAP? CPAP is maintenance of an increased positive transpulmonary pressure during inspiration and expiration phase of respiration, both during, that is, it gives a positive transpulmonary pressure both during inspiration and expiration with the baby breathing spontaneously. Now, how does the CPAP work? When we breathe the air into our lungs, the alveoli are distended by this air. But during expiration, as the air moves out, the alveoli have a tendency to collapse. This is especially true in babies who have surfactant deficiency or respiratory distress syndrome. We all know that surfactant is a surface active agent and it decreases surface tension. Whenever there is a surfactant deficiency, the alveoli collapse at the end expiration. Since the alveoli collapse, there is less exchange of gases, there is decreased oxygenation, leading to acidosis, increased work of breathing, and thus a vicious circle is started. By giving a CPAP, we are distending the alveoli both during inspiration and expiration, and we prevent this end expiratory collapse. So we increase the surface area of gas exchange, we improve oxygenation as well as ventilation, and thereby decrease work of breathing. Now, what are the other methods by which CPAP acts? CPAP is also known to stabilize the chest wall, thereby reducing the airway resistance and improves the VQ mismatch and decreases the intrapulmonary shunt by improving oxygenation. It also splints the upper airway by providing pressure and thereby reduces obstructive apnea. Also, there are certain stretch reflex, stretch receptors, which are also called as J receptors, present in the pleura. So when the CPAP distends the lung, these receptors are activated and they send the signal via vagus for brain to start inspiration. That is, it stimulates the brain to breathe. Thereby, CPAP also has a role in mixed and central apneas. Now, we should know how much to give. Both low and high CPAP can be detrimental. In this diagram here, along the y-axis, we are seeing the volume, and along the x-axis, it is a pressure. Here you can see that with the change in pressure, there is hardly any change in volume. This is the amount of pressure which is required to open up the alveoli. This is required, this much of pressure, usually in clinical scenario, it is around 4 to 5 centimeters of water, which is required to open the alveoli. Therefore, there is hardly any volume change, but this much of pressure is required to open the alveoli. And once the alveoli are open, we see an exponential rise in volume with respect to change in pressure. So this point here is called the lower inflection point. That is the point where we overcome the inherent resistance of the lung and we provide an exponential rise in volume with respect to the pressure. But remember that excess of everything is bad. If we give too much of pressure, that is, if we go beyond the upper inflection point, the alveoli will get over-distended. Over-distension means high risk of air leak. So our aim should be to give CPAP between these two points where we achieve a maximal change in volume per unit change in pressure. We should also know that peripheral, that is pulmonary vascular resistance, increases both at the lower lung volume as well as the higher lung volumes. Lower lung volume is mostly seen in restrictive airway diseases like RDS. And higher lung volumes are seen in obstructive diseases like meconium aspiration syndrome. So we should always maintain an optimal lung volume, which is defined as 6 to 8 air spaces in an X-ray. Anything less than 6 is underinflation, and anything more than 8 spaces is overinflation. Both are detrimental and should be avoided. In the clinical practice, these translate into CPAP pressures of 4 to 8. Below 4, it is hardly of any use. And as you go high, that is beyond 8, the risk of complications increases. So remember, dear friends, that the CPAP is the best ventilator with least damage. Coming to the indications, any preterm who is having respiratory distress or recurrent apnea should be started on CPAP. In a term baby who presents with moderate to severe respiratory distress should be started on CPAP. Most of the babies, especially the VLBWs, after extubation should be put on CPAP to decrease the risk of reintubation. However, remember the first and foremost condition for CPAP to work is that baby should have good spontaneous respiratory efforts. Now coming to the RDS, every preterm baby with RDS should be started on delivery room CPAP. It has already been discussed that use of CPAP decreases the risk of mechanical ventilation and surfactant use by almost 50%. The initial CPAP settings should be around 5 to 6 centimeters of water, and our target should be to maintain a saturation between 90 to 95. That holds true for both preterm as well as term babies. Now, what does the evidence say? According to the latest Cochrane, which is around 6 studies, it shows that when the baby is put on the CPAP compared to the Hood box oxygen, the rate of death as well as the risk of ventilation decreases by almost 35%. It decreases mortality both in VLBW babies and the larger babies. However, the last Cochrane showed that there is increased risk of pneumothorax. But the main caveat in this meta-analysis was that majority, that is 4 out of the 6 studies, were done in pre-surfactant era. And that time, the steroid coverage was very low. That is 20 to 35%. And we know that the surfactant use has decreased the risk of pneumothorax considerably. So the risk, increased risk of pneumothorax shown in this Cochrane analysis does not hold true in present era, where we start the baby on delivery room CPAP and give early rescue surfactant. And we also know that antenatal steroids are very important in managing preterm babies. They decrease morbidity as well as mortality. Therefore, in present era, the risk of pneumothorax does not hold true. For apnea, we know that the lungs are normal. It is only the immaturity of the brain. So minimal pressures of 4 to 5 and minimal FiO2 is required for these babies. And they hardly require any escalation of support. And once the baby is apnea free for at least 24 hours, the CPAP should be removed. However, remember that the main therapy for apnea is caffeine citrate and not the CPAP. Now for post-extubation, the last Cochrane was done in 2007, consists of 8 trials. It showed with the help of CPAP, there is decreased risk of re-intubation to the tune of around 40%. And number needed to benefit is 6. That is, every 6 babies you put on CPAP compared to head box oxygen, you are preventing 1 ventilation. Now, a few lines about surfactant. We all know that surfactant is a surface active agent. It lowers the surface tension. It predominantly consists of phospholipids, the main phospholipid being saturated phosphatidylcholine, which constitutes around 50%, and 8 to 10% of the surfactant is constituted by proteins. There are various types of protein and they have different functions. The main important point to know that a term baby has usually around 100 milligram per kg of surfactant pool, whereas a preterm baby born prematurely with surfactant deficiency has only 10 milligrams per kg of body weight. So that's why we give 100 milligrams per kg of surfactant to replenish that pool to a term equivalent baby. Now, few lines about surface tension. What is surface tension? In simpler terms, it is tension on the surface. On the diagram on the right side, you see a particle which is immersed in the water. It has got forces all over the surface. So these forces, that is, this force will cancel with this force, this will cancel with this force. So it has forces acting all over the surface, and these forces will neutralize each other. So this is a stable particle. However, the particles, water molecules, which are on the air-liquid interface, as is the scenario in the alveoli, they don't have equalizing pressures because the water molecules are only present on the undersurface, not the oversurface. So because of this lack of tension all over the molecule, these molecules have a tendency to collapse and tendency to cohese. That is, they have a tendency to collapse with each other. That is why in absence of surfactant at the air-liquid interface, the alveoli have tendency to collapse. Now, here in this diagram, you see one bigger alveoli on the left and one small alveoli on the right. Here I would like you to remember a common physiological principle called as Laplace's law, where P is the inward tendency of the alveoli to collapse, that is the inward pressure which causes the alveoli to collapse, is proportional to the 2 times T. Here T is the surface tension and R is the radius. So as the surface tension decreases, there will be more tendency of the alveoli to collapse. And as the radius decreases, again, the tendency to collapse will increase. This can be exemplified by a small example. Here we see just by increasing 1 centimeter of radius, we bring down the pressure tendency of the alveoli to collapse by half. So translating this into clinical practice, as we give surfactant, we decrease the surface tension. As we give CPAP, we increase the radius. So giving surfactant and CPAP together, they are additive. That is, on one hand, by giving surfactant, we are decreasing the surface tension. And by giving concomitant CPAP, we are increasing the radius. Thereby, we are stabilizing the alveoli. We are decreasing their tendency to collapse. And it is governed by this law of Laplace. Now, what are the factors which favor distribution of surfactant? Gravity helps in spread of surfactant to the larger airways and helps in the uniform spread. That is why whenever you are giving surfactant, the head should be slightly elevated by around 20 to 30 degrees. Higher volumes lead to better distribution. Rapid administration again leads to better and uniform distribution. And surfactant, when given with CPAP, again leads to better and uniform distribution. You should never shake a surfactant vial. It leads to the wastage of the surfactant by forming the bubbles. Vial once opened should be kept at 2 to 8 degrees Celsius and should not be kept for more than 12 hours. And you should never freeze the surfactant vial. Remember, after giving surfactant, you should always carefully monitor the baby for acute airway obstruction, bradycardias, apnea, hypotension, and you should be ready to wean rapidly. Because by giving surfactant, you're improving the lung compliance dramatically. So if you continue to give high pressures, there may be air leak and increased complications. Now, what are the indications of giving surfactant? Surfactant should be given to a preterm baby with respiratory distress. Any preterm baby who has an FI to recovery rate of more than 30 should be given surfactant. This is as per the latest European Consensus Guidelines on RDS given in 2019. Or any preterm baby who requires intubation at birth for RDS should be given surfactant. Now, when to repeat? Depending on the half-life, various surfactants have various half-lives. Curasurf, which is available in Indian market, has a half-life of 12 hours. So for Curasurf, we can wait for 12 hours. And for other surfactants like Cerventa or Neosurf, we can wait for 6 hours. Even after 6 to 12 hours, if there is increase in the FiO2 requirement or there is worsening respiratory distress, we can repeat a dose. Or if the baby worsens and requires mechanical ventilation, we can repeat a dose of surfactant. Remember, do not do a suction after giving surfactant at least for 2 hours. There is no role of prophylactic surfactant. Remember that early rescue surfactant, that is surfactant given within 2 hours of life, is better than giving it after 2 hours. There are various methods like Ensure and newer methods known as least invasive or minimally invasive surfactant techniques. And remember that change of position is now no more required during surfactant administration. Before giving surfactant, always remember to check the ET tube position by auscultation in the mid axillary line on both sides of the body, that is left and right lung, should be checked for the equal air entry. Because if ET tube is not rightly placed, you may inadvertently give surfactant only to the one lung, leading to more complications and less desirable effects. These are the various preparations which are available in the Indian market. Now, coming to the least invasive surfactant technique, we have also coined a term called as SURE, that is surfactant without endotracheal intubation for LISA, MIST, or Take Care, as they have been known for various names across Europe and America. Now, what makes this least invasive surfactant administration, which uses a thin catheter, promising? Here, we know that during Ensure, we put an AT tube, and after giving surfactant, we give positive pressure breaths with the help of AMBU bag or TPs. And we know that even few breaths of high pressures can be injurious to the lungs and can lead to lung injury. But in giving surfactant by LISA or MIST, we are not giving any positive pressure ventilation. We continue the baby on CPAP, thereby we are not taking the baby off CPAP and we are not letting the alveoli to collapse. Also, in giving surfactant by LISA, the baby is spontaneously breathing, and we know that spontaneous breathing leads to better surfactant distribution. And also, the evidence has shown that giving surfactant by these techniques leads to decreased mechanical ventilation, decreased BPD, and decreased intraventricular hemorrhage. Now, this is the trial which we had done a few years back. This is the largest RCT on least invasive or MIST. In this trial, we showed that the use of surfactant with the use of thin catheter, there was a 50% reduction in the need of mechanical ventilation. Also, the risk of BPD decreased from 17 to 3%. When we compare different methods of least invasive or minimally invasive surfactant technique, there are a few basic differences. First is the device. Some techniques use either a thin feeding tube or a semi-rigid angiocath. We use both, either depending on the ease of the treating physician. We either use 5 French feeding tube or angiocath 60 number by Vigon. And also there is a difference whether some, like Lisa method, uses a Magel forceps, and whereas we do not use any forceps, and it is better to continue CPAP during surfactant administration by thin catheters because you will be maintaining the FRC. Also, there is a difference in these techniques, whether it is given as a single bolus or two boluses and the duration. We usually give it over 60 to 90 seconds, depending on the volume of the surfactant. Now, we have given this classification, which is the first surfactant delivery classification in the world. Here we have divided it into the invasive techniques as ensure, minimally invasive techniques, which consist of sure, that is Lisa, mist, take care, which use thin catheters by you or if you are giving surfactant with the help of laryngeal mask airway or Colmist. Colmist is a combination where you use a laryngeal mask airway as well as thin catheter. And third category is the least invasive technique, which in real sense is nebulization. So using LIST, that is least invasive surfactant technique for surfactant delivery using thin catheters, is actually a misnomer. The actual least invasive technique is giving surfactant by nebulization. But as of now, there is not a good evidence to recommend its use by nebulization. Therefore, surfactant delivery by thin catheters remains the preferred choice of giving surfactant. And this is published in the Acta Pediatrica by the name of Panditas classification. Now, what is the latest evidence? The latest systemic review, which is again published by us in Acta Pediatrica, consists of around 15 studies with around 5,000 babies. We showed that there is a significant decrease in the BPD to the tune of around 50% and decreased need of mechanical ventilation to the tune of around 40%. So there is considerable evidence, good number of babies, good number of studies showing that least invasive surfactant or mist or sure, whatever you call it, is effective and safe. Other network meta-analysis, which is under review in archaic diseases of childhood. Again, we have shown where we have compared different methods of surfactant administration like nebulization, LMA. We have shown that surfactant administration by thin catheters decreases mortality, decreases mechanical ventilation, decreases BPD. It also decreases NEC and PVL. So what else do we want for our babies? Now, coming to the other indication, that is CPAP in meconium aspiration syndrome. Majority of the clinicians have a PPO phobia, that is they avoid giving CPAP in meconium aspiration syndrome, fearing increased risk of air leaks. But again, we use CPAP for meconium aspiration. We start with low pressures of around 5, with FiO2 of around 30 to 50%. And we give surfactant if the FiO2 requirement is more than 50% for 2 hours. And one should avoid antibiotics for meconium aspiration syndrome because it is an inflammatory disorder, not an infection disorder. If a meconium aspiration baby is deteriorating, always remember to rule out PPHN and avoid high pressures of more than 6 centimeters of water, especially if X-ray is showing an obstructive disease. Again, we have done the first of its kind of study of use of CPAP in meconium aspiration syndrome, where we have shown that using CPAP for meconium aspiration syndrome in comparison to the hold box decreases the need for mechanical ventilation from 25% to 3%. That is, every 5 babies you put on CPAP, you are preventing 1 mechanical ventilation. It also decreases the need for surfactant from 16 to 4%. Also, the risk of sepsis was lesser in the CPAP group because of less intervention. Also, important to remember is that there was no increased incidence of air lag in the CPAP arm. Now, there are various types of CPAP available, and broadly they are categorized into fixed flow, which can be either given with the help of bubble CPAP or a ventilator CPAP, and variable flow, which is again given with the help of ventilator, also called as infant flow driver. Now, is there any difference which one we should use? Here in this diagram, there's a tidal volume along the y-axis and the nasal CPAP pressures along the x-axis. Here, the variable flow has been shown to deliver increased tidal volumes. However, these physiological principles have not translated into clinical practice, and each device has shown equal efficacy. So whatever you are comfortable with, whatever you are using in your unit is good for that unit. You don't need to change your practice. No device or no particular machine is superior than the other. Now coming to the interfaces, we have various interfaces available these days in the market, right from binasal prongs to Rams cannula to mask, short binasal Ergel prongs, and other various prongs available. So which one to choose? Now the latest evidence comes from systemic and meta-analysis published in June 2020, where they have taken around 9 studies with around 1,000 babies, and they have shown that using mask compared to short binasal prongs decreases the risk of intubation within 72 hours by almost 30%. And there was also decreased incidence of nasal trauma by around 35%. So nasal mask is the best interface. If you don't have a nasal mask, use short binasal prongs. So the summary is, given the efficacy and the low cost, bubble CPAP seems to be the better option than others in our setting, and facial mask for delivering CPAP is the best interface. Now, when should we see that the baby is on adequate CPAP? The vitals, that is heart rate, blood pressure, saturation, should all be stable. The baby should not be fighting CPAP, he should be comfortable. There should be minimal or no retractions. Saturation should be between 90 to 95. X-ray should show a open lung, that is lung spaces between 6 to 8, and blood gas should show either no acidosis or improvement in acidosis. Now, how to titrate CPAP? There are 3 knobs to play in a CPAP machine. One is CPAP pressure, FiO2 and flow. CPAP pressure, to start with, we start with a pressure of 5 to 6, and we adjust it clinically according to the chest retractions. If there are retractions, that means that alveoli are still not recruited and we need to go on by increasing the pressures. Our aim should be to achieve a saturation of 90 to 95% and an adequate lung volume of 6 to 8 spaces on an X-ray. FiO2, we start around 30 to 50% and we should titrate it as per the saturation and PaO2 in the blood gas. Flow, we usually start with 3 to 5 liters and we should ensure continuous bubbling both during inspiration and expiration in the expiratory rim in a bubble CPAP. Now, for weaning, there are principally 3 methods available. One is the pressure weaning, where we come from high pressures to a predetermined low pressures of around 4 to 5 and then wean. Other type of weaning is called cyclical weaning, where the baby is taken off for CPAP for some hours, then again started on CPAP, then again off and on from CPAP. And the third type of weaning is sudden pressure weaning. That is directly once the baby is stable on minimal FiO2, you take directly stop the CPAP right from the high pressure. That is if the baby is on 7, pressure of 7 or CPAP of 7, you directly take him off CPAP. Now, first we compare cyclical weaning and pressure weaning. The latest Cochrane published in 2011 shows that pressure weaning, that is coming to a low CPAP pressures, is superior to cyclical weaning. Why? Because it decreases the total time spent on CPAP as well as the duration of hospital stay. So pressure reduction is better than cyclical weaning. Now, when we compare pressure versus sudden weaning, there are only 2 trials available, and the latest meta-analysis, which was published again in this month in Neonatology in June 2020, showed that pressure weaning leads to lesser rates of reintubation compared to sudden weaning. So taking both the studies together, that is comparing pressure weaning versus cyclical weaning and pressure weaning versus sudden weaning, pressure weaning is the best mode of weaning. That is, you come down to low pressures of around 4 to 5 and minimal FiO2 of 21 to 30% and then take the baby off CPAP. So you need to identify the disease, treat the disease, and then support the baby on CPAP. Once the disease starts improving, baby comes to minimal settings, you take off the baby from the CPAP. However, during weaning, you should remember law of proportionality. That is, as the baby improves, decrease the FiO2 by 10% half to 1 hourly. And once you have come down on FiO2 by 10%, you should concomitantly decrease CPAP pressures by 1 centimeter of water. That is, there should not be a disproportion between the FiO2 and the pressures. Both should go hand in hand. So this we have already discussed. Now remember that after CPAP, the job is not yet done. Baby can still deteriorate. Baby can still go on requiring CPAP again. That is, there can be CPAP failure, or baby may even worsen further and go on requiring mechanical ventilation. So always remember that after CPAP, you need to do oral and nasal suction. If there are secretions, you should nebulize the baby with the help of saline. You should always watch the baby for apneas, tachypnea, increase work of breathing in the form of retractions or bradycardia. And also there should be a frequent change of posture. When should we consider failure of CPAP? If the baby has continuous retractions, continuous grunt, continuous increased work of breathing, he is not maintaining a PO2 of more than 50, PCO2 is more than 55 to 60, and you should consider that baby is not doing well on CPAP. So consider ventilation if, despite giving surfactant, despite being on maximal CPAP settings of 8 centimeters of water and FiO2 for around 60 to 70%, baby is still not maintaining saturation, consider NIV. If NIV is not successful, consider mechanical ventilation. Now, are there any predictors that which babies will fail CPAP, which will do well on CPAP? There have been various studies, both from India and abroad, which have shown various factors which determine increased risk of failure in the babies, especially the gestation less than 34 weeks and weight of less than 1.25 kgs. These babies are more prone to failure. Also, if there is no or inadequate steroid coverage, baby has a complete whiteout on lung, baby has a other comorbid conditions like PDA, sepsis, or if the FiO2 requirement is more than 50% and there is a severe respiratory distress as shown by Downey's score of more than 7, these babies are more prone to CPAP failure. Also, asphyxia is an important risk factor. Now, what is new in prediction of CPAP is the SF ratio, that is saturation to FiO2 ratio. As the ratio, SF ratio, that is saturation to FiO2 ratio, decreases, there is more chance of failure. Also, these days, the people around the globe are using pulse wave Doppler of right diaphragm to predict which babies are going to fail. They use a pulse wave tissue Doppler spectral test for the right diaphragm. That is, here in this picture, you will show that this is the liver and this is the diaphragm. At the entrance of the hepatic vein, it is taken as the main point where the pulse wave tissue Doppler spectral trace is done. And there are various cutoff given, and this is just a pilot work, and it has a huge potential of research, and it may help, and it may be the main thing by which we decide which babies to put on CPAP and which babies should go on ventilation. However, before considering mechanical ventilation, you should always check that baby is not fighting CPAP interface. You have used an appropriate nasal prongs which are snugly fitted and in position. You are using a humidification which is adequate, that is relative humidity of 100%. There is adequate delivery of CPAP and FiO2. There is no problem with FiO2 delivery. Sometimes there may be a failure of blender, and that is despite giving 70% FiO2, it is only giving 21%. So always you should check FiO2 with the help of a FiO2 meter, and always consider surfactant in babies who deteriorate with RDS before considering mechanical ventilation. Contraindications are very few. If the babies require bag and mask ventilation for recurrent apneas, there is severe hemodynamic instability, babies in severe shock, there are persistent hypercapnia, or there are airways abnormalities in the form of cleft palate, corneal atresia, or diaphragmatic hernia, or TE fistula. These are the candidates where you will not give CPAP. Complications can be device-related in the form of air leak, gastric distension, also called as CPAP belly, which does not require any intervention. Remember, whenever you start any respiratory support, be it invasive or non-invasive, should always pass an OG tube and should keep it open so that whatever air goes into the stomach is vented off. Sometimes if you give excess CPAP, it can lead to decreased venous return, leading to decreased cardiac output. Also, the complications can be interface related, which are predominantly seen as the form of trauma or injury. They can be disease related in the form of, if there is severe sepsis or severe RDS, there can be increased air leak. Remember that careful monitoring and asepsis is the key to prevent such complications. Now, what is new is that we have again shown that CPAP can lead to CPAP paralysis if you are not using an interface which is attached properly. Here in this diagram, we'll show that if the interface is such that it is pressing on the stylomastoid foramen and it is held too tightly, it can compress the facial nerve at the exit and can lead to transient facial paralysis. We have again observed this in our unit and we have published it as a case series in BMG, and it's also preventable. So after that, we changed the interface and we used cotton to pad these interfaces. And after that, we did not see any facial paralysis in our unit. Remember, counseling is important these days, especially in the era of increased medico-legal litigations. Also, our aim should be to ensure comfort and allay anxiety for the parents. We should be both empathetic as well as sympathetic. We should be sensitive, especially on the day one, where the anxieties are maximal. We should counsel at least 3 to 4 times. We should all answer all their questions. Remember, CPAP is a procedure. So whenever you are starting a CPAP, and it is not free of complications. So whenever you are starting a CPAP, always take consent from the parents. All babies who are admitted in ICU are prone to neurological impairment. So always developmental supportive care should be a hand in hand along with the other respiratory support. Baby who is on CPAP should be swaddled and should have containment. You should promote day-night cycling by switching off the lights during nighttime. There should be minimal sound levels of less than 50 decibels in your unit. Avoid talking loudly at the bedside. You should also set the alarm limits to the minimal level, and you should always answer alarms. There should not be any alarm fatigue in any unit. Parents should be involved in the nursing care, and KFC and KMC, that is kangaroo family care or mother care, are possible for babies who are on CPAP. So take home messages are that CPAP is the backbone of neonatal respiratory care. CPAP is safe and effective. Surfactant is an important adjuvant to CPAP. Sure technique, or also called as lease or mist, is feasible and safe. But remember, it needs proper training. If you are doing it without proper training, it can lead to more harm. Complications are few with CPAP, but do occur. Patient counseling is a must. And remember the famous saying by Dr. Alan Job. He is one of the pioneers of respiratory support. He says that there is perhaps nothing more dangerous for the preterm lung than an anxious physician with an endotracheal tube and bag. Just don't do something. Stand with the patient and take decisions accordingly. Nothing can be more effective than your clinical judgment. Thank you so much for your patient listening.
Sir, we have received few questions.
Yeah, please go on.
Yes, sir. How do we determine optimal CPAP pressure at bedside?
Very good question, and we all should know it. Once that we have started the baby on initial pressures of around 5 to 6, we should look for the retraction. Usually, if adequate CPAP pressure has been given, the retraction should cease within 15 to 20 minutes. If the baby continues to have retraction, that means our pressures are lesser. We need to go high on pressures. Other important thing is saturation. If the baby is not saturating well, his saturation is less than 90. Again, we should go first on pressures, then on FiO2, because there is something called open lung concept. If you don't open the lungs, if you don't open the alveoli, as giving 100% FiO2 will not work. And the third thing is in X-ray. Whenever X-ray is done, if you are giving an adequate CPAP, you will be able to see adequate lung expansion, which is usually seen as lung spaces of around between six to eight. If there are less than 6 spaces, that means your lung is still not opened up, alveoli are still collapsed. So you need to go on pressure. But the best and important thing is to look for retractions. If there are retractions, that means the pressure is not adequate.
Okay, sir. Sir, another one, sir. Is there any feature by which we can suspect impending pneumothorax in case of RDS baby getting CPAP ventilation? What is the management of CPAP belly syndrome?
One by one. What is the first question?
No, sir. First question was, is there feature by which we can suspect impending pneumothorax in case of RDS baby getting CPAP ventilation?
Okay. In the present era where we are using delivery room CPAP and surfactant, pneumothorax is rare, hardly around less than 2%. But remember that if you are using adequate CPAP between 5 to 8, the risk of pneumothorax is almost negligible. But however, in babies like meconium aspiration, if an X-ray is showing over distension already before starting CPAP, those are the babies where you should consider mechanical ventilation earlier. Clinically, bedside, you should always, whenever there is a slight suspicion of pneumothorax, you should do a transillumination test, which is a bedside test which can pick up the pneumothorax early. Not all pneumothoraxes require intervention, and not all pneumothorax are contraindication for CPAP. If it is a minimal pneumothorax, which is not causing any cardiorespiratory embarrassment, you can still continue CPAP. Only if there is worsening of respiratory distress, there is cardiovascular compromise, if it's a tension pneumothorax, you need to do a needle drainage. If it is a large pneumothorax, the thing will be first do a needle drainage followed by ICD. What was the next question? Next question is regarding CPAP belly.
Yeah, what is the management of CPAP belly syndrome?
Remember that CPAP belly is a common condition, but it is a very benign condition. Again, I would like to emphasize here that starting a baby on CPAP is not a contraindication for feeding. So any baby on CPAP can be on full feeds if he is hemodynamically stable and there are no other contraindications. Remember, whenever you are starting any baby on any respiratory support, be it CPAP, NIV, HFNC or ventilation, always put a nasogastric tube in place and always keep it open so that the air, whatever air goes into the stomach, is vented off. So it just needs an observation and ensure that OG tube is in position. CPAP belly will recover of its own.
Okay, sir. So there is one more question from Dr. Nargis from Dhaka. How to reduce CPAP-induced nasal septal destruction in VLBW baby?
Again, an excellent question. It is a common complication which we all see in our unit. First is that use mask if it is available. There is a 30% reduction of the nasal trauma with the help of nasal mask if you are using nasal mask compared to the shot by nasal prongs. Other thing you can use is in babies more than 1 kg, that is more than 28 weaker babies, you can use Ram's cannula for giving CPAP. Again, the incidence of nasal trauma is very less. If you do not have mask, you do not have Ram's cannula, other things which are, there is a barrier cream by the various companies have various colloidal creams which can be applied before giving CPAP, or there is something called as cannulate, which can be placed over the nostrils before giving CPAP. They provide a padding type of cushioning below the interface, which can prevent nasal injury. If you do not have these fancy items, you can use a simple Tegaderm before putting on the CPAP interface. It will help in preventing the nasal injury. And last but not the least is careful monitoring. During each nursing shift, the CPAP monitoring chart should also have a column for nasal injury. During every shift, the prong should be removed, the nose should be suctioned. You should always look for the initial signs of the nasal injury in the form of hyperemia or blanching. Hyperemia and blanching of the nose are the earliest signs of nasal trauma. If you pick the nasal trauma early, you are surely going to prevent nasal injury in your unit.
Sir, do you advocate caffeine with CPAP in RDS in VLBW baby?
The importance of caffeine is that it improves the neurodevelopment outcome and increases BPD. So any VLBW less than 1.25 kgs who is requiring CPAP should be started on caffeine within first 48 hours of life to get the maximum benefit.
So there is one more question from Dr. Nargis. In case of RDS, how do you decide that second dose of surfactant will not require, or you will give two doses always?
Not many babies require the second dose. If after giving surfactant, the baby's respiratory distress comes down, FiO2 requirement does not go up, it either remains same or comes down, the work of breathing comes down, then definitely you don't need a second dose. However, if the baby worsens, the work of breathing worsens, the FiO2 requirement increases, there is increased retractions, increased work of breathing, or the baby requires ventilation subsequently, then you need to consider a second dose after 6 to 12 hours of the first dose, depending on what type of surfactant you have used.
Sir, can we keep baby in prone position on CPAP?
Definitely, prone positioning is shown to improve oxygenation. You should, in fact, keep the babies on prone position whenever possible. For any baby who's having respiratory distress, the prone position is the preferred position.
Sir, Mrs. Sahana Akhtar, she also wants to know regarding mechanical ventilation.
Sorry, this webinar is only on CPAP. So questions on mechanical ventilation, we'll do a separate webinar and then we'll take on mechanical ventilation. Here, we'll limit ourselves to CPAP and surfactant.
Okay, sir. Sir, how to tackle high temperature in humidifier?
That means either your heating wire is not working or your humidifier is not working. So you need to see both. The wiring has to be proper and the heating element has to be proper. And the set temperature, if it is a manual humidifier, then the set temperature has to be 37 degrees Celsius. If you have set very high temperatures, then that can be one of the causes. If it is automatic, then definitely other causes like malfunction of the humidifier needs to be checked and it needs to be changed.
Okay, sir, how sudden weaning of CPAP done?
Pardon?
How sudden weaning of CPAP done?
Sudden weaning of CPAP should not be done, especially in VLBW babies, because the risk of reintubation are higher. By sudden removal of CPAP, we mean that if the maximal settings of for a particular baby is that he requires a CPAP of 7 and FiO2 of 50%. So once the FiO2 has come down to 30%, he's still on pressures of 7, you directly take off the CPAP. So it may work well for the larger babies, but smaller babies less than 28 weeks, sudden weaning should not be done.
Okay, sir.
It will lead to more chance of reintubation.
Okay, sir. Sir, do we need to do an ABG routinely in a baby on CPAP?
Ideally, yes. Any baby who's on CPAP, in fact, before CPAP, only majority of the babies will require a blood gas. And also, if the baby is doing fine on CPAP, you don't need to repeat. However, if the baby is deteriorating, there is clinical deterioration, you will require to need to do a CPAP to see whether he is going into acidosis or there is hypercarbia and may require ventilation.
Okay, sir. Sir, is there any adverse effect of surfactant administration like pulmonary hemorrhage?
Yeah, previously during the when with the surfactants were available with it without the protein, that is the synthetic surfactant without protein, that time we had seen the majority of the pulmonary hemorrhages were reported during that time. However, with the help of recent surfactants which have come along with the proteins, the risk of pulmonary hemorrhage is least or almost negligible. Also, there are many other common complications apart from pulmonary hemorrhage like obstruction, apnea, bradycardia, sepsis, which can take place. Okay. Pulmonary hemorrhage these days with the newer surfactant is almost rare.
Okay, sir.
Although it is there.
Sir, what happens if baby's mouth continues to remain open? Does chin strapping have any role or evidence in this?
Again, a very good question and a very practical question. If the baby, there can be various reasons for opening mouth. If the baby is crying excessively, that means his FRC is good. He does not require CPAP. Most of the times this happens in term babies. Other conditions, if the baby is keeping his mouth open, that means your setting are not adequate. Either you are giving low pressures or you are giving very high pressures. Or if the baby or the interface is causing pain to the baby, or there is a wet diaper which needs to be changed. So generally speaking, majority of the babies who are on adequate CPAP settings will not keep their mouth persistently open. If it is open, rule out pain, rule out wet diaper, rule out other causes like hypothermia, hyperthermia. And you should not, regarding chin strapping, it is not recommended.
Okay, sir. So this is a very long question from Dr. Ismat Jahan. Do we need to consider course of the disease while providing CPAP? Can we win?
Okay. Yeah, definitely. Sometimes if the baby is, very good question. If the baby is a big baby, term baby, you can wean the CPAP more rapidly, especially in cases of TTN. But if the baby is extreme premature, less than 28 weeker, that is around 25 to 26 weaker, even though he's on stable on CPAP, on minimal settings, you may tend to delay the weaning, because CPAP has been shown to improve the lung growth. So in those babies, ALBW babies, those babies who had turbulent course, who have other comorbid conditions, there you will go more slowly.
Can we wean from CPAP within first 24 to 48 hours in case of moderate RDS if baby shows rapid clinical improvement?
Definitely for bigger babies, definitely yes. And smaller babies, more than 28 weeks also, we can wean off.
Okay. So do we wean abruptly, or we need to go on with same setting for a particular period of time to resolve the disease?
As we have discussed, that pressure weaning, that is coming to a pressure of around 4 to 5 and FI of around 30%, is the best strategy to wean for any baby with any disease.
Okay, sir. Sir, which surfactant should be considered best, Alveofact versus Survanta?
All surfactants, if given in equal doses, are equally effective. No surfactant is superior to the other.
Okay, sir.
On sir, dose basis.
Okay, sir. Sir, if CPAP pressure is more than 5 cm and FIU2 more than 50%, which should be reduced first?
Definitely, if CPAP is already 5, that is, you are sitting on minimal pressures. So definitely, only thing which you can reduce is FIO2. CPAP, from CPAP of 5, you can directly reduce. That is the starting CPAP, that much of pressure we usually give for any respiratory distress. So FIO2 of 50%, you need to come down to 30% before weaning. So once you come down to FIO2 of 30% and CPAP of 5, you can wean the baby.
Okay, sir. Sir, how we should increase CPAP pressure in case of progressive respiratory distress?
You should increase by 1 centimeter of water every 10 to 15 minutes if there are persistent retractions or baby is not maintaining saturation.
Okay. Okay, sir. Sir, do we need to do an ABG to see the response of the setting or change in setting?
No. That means every 10 minutes you cannot do a blood gas. Once you have achieved, based on your clinical judgment, you have achieved and adequate pressures and adequate FIO2 and baby's maintaining saturation, he's looking stable, disease is improving, you don't need to do a blood gas. Only if there is deterioration, baby's not improving, then you need to repeat a blood gas. Otherwise, no need for a stable, improving baby.
Okay, sir. Sir, how do we know humidification is not working in CPAP? What's the problem of that?
If there will be excessive watering of the circuit, that is, the inspiratory, there will be too much of condensation. Also, if you touch the inspiratory wire, it will not be warm to touch.
Okay, sir. Sir, which one is better, early CPAP or early surfactant?
Definitely, surfactant can be given only when the baby is on CPAP. Surfactant cannot be given without CPAP. So CPAP, because majority of the babies are started on CPAP. Any baby with respiratory distress has to be started on CPAP, but surfactant requirement is not required by all babies with respiratory distress. Only 40% of the babies, premature babies who are on CPAP require surfactant. So CPAP is the mainstay, surfactant may or may not be required.
Okay, sir. Sir, how do you tackle pain from nasal prong interface by dextrose?
Excellent question. Again, mother's milk is the best. You can give mother drops of mother's milk. Containment, cuddling are the other measures. Non-invasive should be preferred, especially breast milk, containment, then some light music, if that is a practice of your unit, dim lights, minimal noise. These are the main effective measures for preventing pain. And also the interface should not be abutting the nose. It should not be too tight.
Okay, sir. Sir, on a baby on CPAP, how long we have to keep the OG tube end closed after each feed?
You can open the OG tube after half an hour, 20 to 30 minutes after giving feed, you can keep the OG tube open.
Okay, sir. That's it, sir. No more questions. Thank you, sir, for presenting for such an informative session. I would also like to mention that today we had few participants from overseas also. I think everyone has enjoyed and learned a lot of things from your talk today, sir. So thank you very much, sir. And thanks to all the participants for joining us today. We'll be back soon with our next session of webinar.
Thank you so much. Thank you all for patient listening.